HarperCollins presents The Couple on Maple Drive by Sam Carrington, read by Georgia Maguire, with Beth Chalmers, Russell Bentley, John Hopkins, and Elliot Fitzpatrick. Chapter 1. Christie's Crime Addicts, True Crime Podcast. Live stream with Doug, Ed, and Christie.
Hi all, Doug here. Well, it's all happening in the Bay, listeners. Just after we hit the stop button on today's recording, we had news of a developing situation right here in our English Riviera. I reckon Agatha Christie herself would be following along if she could. We thought we'd tag this onto the end of the usual podcast to let you know the armchair detectives are all over it. I've got Ed on the phone from the scene. So, Ed, bring us up to speed. What's happening in Torquay right now?
Well, there's a heavy police presence in the Wellswood area, Doug. One of our regular podcast listeners gave us the heads up, and we got ourselves straight here.
Any specifics yet?
Sketchy at the moment. We're down a team member today too, so it's just Christie doing the behind-the-scenes searching while we're live on air. Oh, hang on. Christie's here now.
Hey, this incident's working its way through the usual social media channels. I see Devon Live has just posted something.
Well, we'll do our own research, eh?
Yeah, sure thing.
Some onlookers are messaging me saying there's some movement outside a house. Can you see anything?
A body, perhaps. I'm trying to get it closer. It looks like police are bringing someone out.
Do you guys think it could be a murder?
Forensics are on scene. Maybe. I'll leave you with Christie while I see if I can find a credible source.
Well, true crime fans, looks like we might have a serious one on our doorstep. As this is early news, we'll keep digging and bring you more tomorrow following our planned podcast. As ever, let us know if you've any information to share. We'll be live again just after 10 a.m. In the meantime, Christie's Crime Addicts wish you a safe day in the Bay.
Chapter 2. Isla gingerly shifted sideways and stretched her good arm down between the sofa and wall, her hand feeling for the TV remote. She lifted it back up, together with an empty Galaxy wrapper. Wrinkling her nose, she unballed it to check if any shards of chocolate remained. Disappointed it was completely void of even one crumb, she screwed it back up again, launching it towards the waste paper bin, which it missed by a foot, realigned the cushions snugly behind her back, and returned her attention to the telly. The 103 run of Murder, She Wrote played on the screen. It didn't matter how many times she'd seen the episodes, they made a great distraction. Good old Jessica Fletcher. She always found the culprit. The show was a childhood favourite, one she'd always watched during the good days with her parents and older brother back in Scotland. It was her go-to cosy crime programme when she was feeling low, glum, bored, depressed, lonely, scared. Isla shook off the feeling. Her home was a safe space. She had to slow the thoughts in her head, make them go from fearful to positive. That's what the online therapy course had encouraged her to do. Or something like that. It was positive, anyway. No more dwelling on what had happened, what she couldn't change. She must focus on the measures she could take to help herself, not on her reactions to the event, not on feeling helpless. Look forward to where you are heading, not back to where you've come from. The middle-aged, mothering voice of Dr. Emile Forrester told her. Easier said than done. And it's why she'd slammed down her laptop screen and diverted her attention to fiction instead. All that talk of optimism, the psychobabble nonsense, was giving her a headache. Of course, when Zach returned home from work later, she'd tell him she'd completed the day's online workshop, filled in her therapy journal as instructed. Everything she'd promised Zach she'd keep doing. It's not as though he'd check up on her, was it? What he didn't know couldn't hurt him. Isla felt a flash of guilt. He was only trying his best, ensuring she had a fighting chance of recovering mentally as well as physically. Although the bruising was slowly fading, the fractured wrist bone mending, her mind was failing to heal as quickly. Her confidence had been knocked, her vulnerability brought into sharp focus. Zach intended to rectify that. His idea to move in had been a life-saving act in her eyes, Although their relationship hadn't quite been there yet, if she were being honest. They were work colleagues of sorts. She'd known of him since she first started as an intern at his father's financial company, but they hadn't become an item until 3 months ago. Isla had put off agreeing to a date with the boss's son for numerous reasons, some more obvious than others. They'd bypassed a lot of moving-in-together chat once it became clear she would need extra support following the attack. And Zach had been only too keen to offer himself up as housemate potential. It made sense, he'd said, and he'd been right. Isla had needed him. Probably still needed him. The end credits rolled impossibly quickly up the screen, and Isla immediately flicked to Netflix and began scrolling through the dozens of programmes in her continue-watching list. All true-life crime documentaries or crime series. She clicked on Unsolved Mysteries and picked up where she'd left off yesterday. She didn't watch these programmes while Zach was home, and luckily for her, he rarely switched to Netflix. He was more into current affairs, news channels and stuff on Sky. He'd be unlikely to uncover her daily crime fix obsession. It had become worse since the attack. She felt compelled to watch everything relating to crime, to delve into the minds of criminals, figure out their motivation, the reasons they gave for what they'd done. It wasn't because she thought it was helping her. In fact, most people would be against her habit, telling her not to think too hard about perpetrators of crime, of the bad people out in the world. But for Isla, understanding the underlying factors, having knowledge of the whys, was something she needed in order to help her recognise dangerous people and situations in the future. You shouldn't have been walking on your own. She'd heard those words a dozen times since it happened, both from the accusatory voice in her head and from well-meaning family, friends and colleagues. Together with, you put yourself in such a risky situation, Isla. But why? Why shouldn't she have been out on her own in the town she lived in? How come walking in the street alone at night is classed as putting yourself at risk? As far as she was concerned, she had every right to do that and shouldn't be in fear of her life, fearful of what someone else might do to her if she didn't adhere to the unwritten rules of being a woman. Isla was fearful, though. As much as she argued against the reasoning, she couldn't shake the anxiety created by the person who mugged her. He'd taken away her right to feel safe. He'd not only stolen her mobile phone and handbag, he'd stolen her confidence, forced her to put up a protective wall. And with each day, tucked away from the real world, cocooned within her own four walls, she was becoming something less. She'd lost control of her life through the actions of someone else, and despite the therapy suggesting she would be able to take it back, her mind had yet to believe the claim. She knew she had to focus on herself, on the steps she could take, but for now, she was obsessing far more about the actions he'd taken, and whether he would strike again. Chapter 3. As Zach approached Isla's rented, semi-detached house, he noted that the curtains to the front room bay window were drawn again. It wasn't even dark, yet she'd already shut herself off to the outside world. In fact, he doubted they'd been pulled back at all, and she'd likely been cooped up in there, the heavy, grey blackout material obliterating natural light for the entire day. He gave a furtive glance towards the adjoining house as he climbed the steps, wondering if they'd noticed the closed curtains day in, day out. Probably not, he concluded. He'd never even met the couple next door. Isla said they weren't the type of neighbours who popped in for a coffee and a chinwag. He paused as he reached the top step, his gaze fixed on the chrome number 5 on the door and fingers gripping the key as he contemplated the scene about to greet him. Isla would be on the large, bottle-green-coloured sofa, legs sprawled to the side of her, remote control in hand when he walked inside. The position he'd found her in on each of the previous evenings spanning the last 2 weeks. He was trying to be supportive and understanding. She'd experienced a traumatic event, physically and psychologically. Of course it would affect her badly. But he wished she would show signs of progression. Something positive, however little, in the right direction. He'd organised online therapy sessions, texted or rung throughout the day, made sure she had a phone to receive messages from her family and friends, and was being as patient as possible with her when he got home from work. There was only so much he could do to help her, though, and he was running out of ideas. He didn't want to come across as pushy, and he didn't want to rush her, as that was the last thing she needed. He was there, by her side. Maybe that was all that mattered for now. She'd said she felt safer with him living there, so that was his current role. Like her, he needed to take it one day at a time. Zack inhaled deeply, turned the key, and pushed the door open. "Hello, my gorgeous lady, how are you?" he called. He dropped his briefcase beside the round, antique wood hall table, carried on down the hallway to the lounge, and approached the sofa, bending over to kiss the top of Isla's head. A musty odour mixed with a sour scent wafted upwards. She had the same pyjamas on as when he left her this morning, a pale blue top with her initials embroidered on and black checkered bottoms, the same ones she'd been wearing for at least a week. Had she even washed today? "Fine, thanks. How was work?" Isla slowly swung her legs off the sofa and pushed herself up with her good arm, turning to face him. She winced with the movement. The bruising was obviously still causing her some discomfort. Zack almost winced himself as he noted Isla's colourless complexion. Her skin looked practically translucent. He decided not to comment on it, aware it was an observation he should keep to himself. He'd have to keep a closer eye on her, make sure she was eating properly. "I'll tell you over dinner," Zack sighed, widening his eyes. "I've had a bastard of a day."
"Oh no, I'm sorry. Is it because you're one down? Has your father not brought someone in to take up the slack while I'm off?"
No, his father had not drafted in any support, deciding it wasn't required yet. Basically, Zack had assumed he'd rather save the money and merely share out Isla's work among the executives. Kenneth Biggins was what was commonly known as tight as a duck's arse. It's how he made his money in the first place, he'd often told Zack. He called himself frugal. His employees called him Scrooge. Not Mr. Big, like he thought. Zack had never had the heart, no, the guts, to inform him otherwise. "Don't worry yourself over it, babe." Zack batted her concern away with a flick of his wrist. "Have you spoken with your mum today?"
"Of course," Isla said.
There was a hint of weariness to her voice, and he wasn't sure if it was because he'd asked or because she was tired of her mother's daily phone calls. Living at the other end of the UK was taking its toll on Isla's mum. She'd made no bones about the fact she would rather be at Isla's side during this time, but due to her own health concerns, she'd had to make do with checking up on her daughter via telephone. Zack had also reassured her she was being well looked after, so not to worry about putting her health at risk to travel such a long distance.
"She needs to check in with you, that's all," he said.
"I don't have anything new to tell her, though. We end up talking about Fraser and what he's up to. I swear, my brother stopped growing up once he hit 18, you know."
"You'll have more to talk about when you're back to work."
Zack kissed her again, then headed for the kitchen before his words sank in.
"Fancy a Chinese tonight?" he called.
There was a pause before she responded, and Zack imagined she was debating whether to say anything about his comment. He knew she didn't feel ready to return to the office, and he couldn't rush her. He was keen to get an indication, though, as in theory she was physically able to conduct her role at the business now, and he was acutely aware his father put the needs of the business before those of his employees. Even his family came second to his blessed company.
"Sure," Isla shouted finally.
Zack rolled his head and pushed his shoulders down, attempting to relieve the built-up tension. The muscles in his neck were rigid, like a slab of stone. A hot shower with the water jets all hammering his back would be just the ticket. He found the takeaway menu and called up, placing an order to be delivered. He tidied away the breakfast bowl Isla had left on the worktop, wiped down the granite surfaces, and then put out the plates and cutlery ready for the food.
After taking two glasses from the cupboard, he filled one with chilled Sauvignon Blanc and the other with a pre-mixed G&T. He didn't see the attraction in the cans Isla stocked in the fridge. He was sure they had barely any alcohol content. May as well drink fizzy pop. Although maybe that was the point.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.